Welcome. We're glad you're here with us. Here's some music while we get ready. We'll start at 11.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Glad you're with us today. A few announcements as we get started. If you have any joys or concerns, please share them in the comments below or just directly to me on my cell phone. Also, a congratulations to Billy and Amanda. Last week they got married, so congratulations. Thank you. And continue to send your offering to Lot Heights at this address and at Wesley Chapel at the other address. Also, continuing on, next week we'll actually be doing in-person worship in the Fellowship Hall at Wesley Chapel. Everyone's welcome to come. Please bring a mask, and it'll be at 11 o'clock next Sunday. And we'll spread out and lots of other things, so we'll be, actually be able to be together again. But we'll also continue to video in streaming, so know that that's still an option. And that's all the announcements we have. So let us prepare our hearts and minds as we go to God in worship. Surrender to God's mercy. We thank you, O Lord, for hearing the prayers of our hearts. We are being called to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, guide our feet as we enter into this pathway of service for you. It is not going to be easy. Some will not welcome us. Some will not.
Lord, help us pick ourselves up, dust ourselves off, and start over again.
Some people are going to misunderstand. Help us to be clear and faithful, bringing your message of redemption. Now let us join together in our opening prayer. God of pain and suffering, you embrace us in our need. Out of our deep need, we enter your holy temple, seeking your presence and guidance. As we gather for worship, you know our deepest needs. You embrace our most desperate hopes. Come to us and quicken the spirit that is struggling within us. Live in us today that we may be a people who rise above the storms that threaten to overcome us. And Jesus charged his disciples, deliver now your charge to us and lead us as he led them into the fields ready to harvest that we may become faithful laborers in your vineyard. We ask this through the one who came that we might have life and have it abundantly. Amen. Now let us join together in our opening hymn, Christ for the World We Sing. Familiar tune, maybe different words.
Thank you.
9, verse 35. Then Jesus went about all the cities and the villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom of God, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples, and he gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, son of Zebedee, and brother John, Philip, and Bartholomew, Thomas, and Matthew, the tax collector, James, son of Aphtheros, and Thaddeus, Simon of Cana, and Judas Iscariot, the one who would betray him. These 12 Jesus sent out to go and follow these instructions. Go nowhere among Gentiles, and enter no town of Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, only two tunics or sandals, no sandals, or no staff or laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who is in it worthy to stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave the house. Truly, I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I'm sending you out like sheep amidst the wolves. So be as wise as serpents, as innocent as doves. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today our gospel shows us Jesus, who is moved with empathy. He unites word and action on the one hand. On the other hand, Jesus teaches us to announce the good news of the kingdom of God. He tells us to send out to cure all kinds of diseases and ailments. In other words, we're not limited to announcing the message of God, but also to put those teachings into practice. His understanding allows him to see and sympathize with those who are dejected, with those who are tired and disoriented. Undoubtedly, the task was vast, which is why he chooses the disciples he did, and those who sent as agents, and those who would be ambassadors for his mission in the future. But what did Jesus really see? Jesus saw people dejected and confused, overwhelmed and helpless. The religious leaders of that time, far from offering guidance or comfort or strength, they loaded them with an unbearable yoke of the law. The faith that those people was not spontaneous, result of someone who gratefully responds to an announcement of good news. No, it was rather forced, lived, and contradictory. As it says in Mark 12, "Do what I say, but not what I do." Beware of the teachers of the law who strip widows of their property and they make long prayers. Jesus had a wide, deep gaze, full of mercy and grace, seeing more than just impure hands, not having to fulfill the rituals of purity. Jesus sees the hearts of those considered to be lost sinners by religious leaders. Jesus was always moved by love and compassion, a love that is capable of sacrifice in order to save the marginalized and despised. The word compassion is more than pity. It derives from the Greek noun entrails. In other words, it was an intimate compassion that moved him from his gut, from the depths of his being. It would be like making the pain of others your own. Empathy. There were many in the situations of pain and suffering and sadness and loneliness, exclusion that twisted and compelled Jesus to bring relief to those unhappy people. He was able to see the need, and he saw a huge harvest. So he said to the 12, why 12? 12 because of the 12 tribes of Israel. And Jesus now is thinking of the people of God the new people, renewed, living according to God's way. Those 12 were just men, ordinary workers. They were not intellectuals, nor did they have academic training. They did not belong to a high social class, nor were they strict law enforcement officers. But they listened to the word of Jesus. They believed in him. They chose to follow him despite their fears and hesitations at first. Jesus chose them to accompany him, to learn from him, so that they would be his friends, his witnesses, and his ambassadors of his words, his life, and his works. In truth, the disciples were actually a good mix. At least four were fishermen. One was a tax collector, one was a Canaanite, another a zealot, and another would become a traitor, which clearly shows they were not perfect people. Incredibly, despite the differences, they were able to live together in peace for a common mission. Today, our church, we each have our own cultural backgrounds, our life story. We all have different personalities and temperaments, but strive to be united by the same love for the one who calls us and saves us. Jesus continues calling and inviting, but we're not coerced or forced to act. In us is the freedom to accept or reject that invitation. Jesus still needs disciples, full of grace and willing hearts, with the desire to learn in order to serve. Jesus calls us, not because of our merits, not because we have earned it, the position or title, because we had compassion, because he had compassion on us for the one who told us about him. In truth, that sometimes we feel like those wounded and disoriented, confused sheep, waiting for Jesus, the Good Shepherd, the necessary help for our fragility and our dependence. But on the other hand, Jesus challenges us to be those workers who go out and meet those needs, because the task is ongoing, because imparting faith and announcing the kingdom of God in its fullness has no end. So we must pray that the owner of the harvest will always send more and more workers. If Jesus walked through our cities and towns today, he would experience the same thing that he did then, an urgency of compassion and empathy, countless struggle and hunger and disease, sickness, violence, and oppression, needing some charitable shepherd who will feed them and shelter them and offer hope of a better day. Yet there are hungry wolves disguised as lambs that look with greed and ambition at lives lacking the most basic necessities of life. This is a call, an invitation to the church, because there are still those who are hungry, poverty-stricken people who are still marginalized and oppressed today. There are still people who are tired and dejected who need support and comfort and solidarity. This week, as I was researching my devotion, I came across a quotation from William Booth, the co-founder of the Salvation Army. He said, in 1912, "While women weep as they do, I will fight. While children go hungry, as they do now, I'll fight. While men go to prison and out, in and out, in and out, as they do now, I'll fight. While there is a drunkard left, there's a poor lost girl upon the streets. While there remains one dark soul without the light of God, I'll fight. I'll fight to the very end." The mission of the church is to make disciples that follow Christ Jesus. The passage from Matthew's gospel today gives us a realistic answer to what it means to be a disciple. The answer that speaks to us and as we strive to be the church in the future. Jesus models three tasks of ministry: teaching, healing or serving, and proclaiming. And then guides the 12 towards their own journeys as bringers of good news. And this is what we are called to do. Although our circumstances are not the same as they were in Jesus' time, we must do it in his way, following his strategy. He seeks, he calls, he teaches. He trains, he announces the good news, he heals, and he sends. There are tired and discouraged people that need help. There are impoverished sheep that roam looking for food, looking for water, for better conditions. This is how it was in Jesus' day, and it's the same 2,000 years later. Jesus' work is our work. There are situations that overcome us. This is why the call for more workers is urgent. More hands make light work. And just as Jesus carefully prepared his followers' teachings, teaching them ethical principles to respond to the enormous demands that were before them, we need to do the same, to educate ourselves and get ready. The disciples are called to be realistic about the possibilities and the opposition from local communities they visit. Some will welcome them, and some will not. Some will hear the message, and some will misunderstand it. The teacher encourages them to travel simply, no extra clothes or food, other hindrances to keep their balance if they are not welcome or treated peacefully as our travels. Then we come to this wonderful vivid image of shaking the dust from one's feet in verse 14. It evokes a modern song lyric that advises the bereaved lover, pick yourself up, dust yourself off, and start over again. The parallel is appropriate for discipleship. For discipleship is love affair with the world God still loves. Today, it is also essential for us to discover and enhance our gifts and skills and knowledge and put them to work for the kingdom. Jesus acts as trainer for this small motley crew of people with a holy glimmer in their eye. Those 12 named men, like us, are individuals. They didn't just wake up and become disciples. They, like us, had to grow into that identity. Today, it takes prayer and vision, realism about the positive and negative life's aspects of life, support for one another, an ongoing ministry together. The best candidate for Jesus' discipleship school were those who had as many needs as they had skills, just like us. Like us, they had to be teachable, open to new information, and not so convinced of their own perfection that they would preach the gospel of ego or self-righteousness judgment of the world. The mission of the church is to teach, to live, and to serve in the way of Jesus, where all are welcome, where the hopeless find hope, where virtues such as grace and peace and justice prevail over hatred and injustice and violence. O God, help us be the good workers and efficient workers in your vineyard, in your harvest. Amen. And now let's go to God as we sing one more time. Help us to discover the gifts of confidence to accompany the tired. Tune our ears to that what you call us to do, that we can no longer bathe, to help those who no longer can weigh the pain of life. When we find ourselves in difficult times, please fill us with your peace and hope. Give us wisdom and strength and creativity. You have called us to be people of peace and love and serve you no matter what life circumstances have for us. May we be better. May we find ourselves in difficult times. Please fill us with your peace and hope and give us wisdom and strength and creativity we need to share the peace and hope with anyone who we come in any way we can. God of mercy and healing, you hear the cries of those in need. Receive these petitions of the people here gathered in this time to know your peace and comfort and courage. As we those we know in particular circumstances of stress that weigh heavy on our hearts that we lift up to you now, O God. We continue to pray for Irene. God, we ask that you would surround her in your peace and healing touch, that she may regain her strength. We pray for the Whitson family as they process the loss of Leah Austin. We pray for the Payne and Button families with the loss of their son and grandson, Nikki. We pray for Mary, who's having surgery in Germany this Thursday. We pray for peace of mind and strength. We pray for Tammy and Tracy. We pray for those concerns which weigh heavy on our hearts that we lift up to you now. O Holy One, we come to you in this moment of uncertainty and uncharted territory. Amidst universal fear and panic, Help us, remind us that you are the God that calmed the storms, that made the wind cease. O God, our healer, show compassion on the whole human family that's in turmoil and burdened with illness and sickness and fear. Heal those who are sick, support and protect their families and friends from being infected. Hold in your gentle embrace all who have died and all who will die. Comfort those loved ones in their despair. Heal our world and strengthen our hearts and our minds. In the midst of turmoil, give us hope. Heal our self-centeredness and indifference that makes us only worry about ourselves. Open us to ways beyond our hesitation and fear that too easily ignore our neighbor. Strengthen and encourage those in public service, health service, and medical profession, caregivers and nurses, attendants and doctors, and all who commit themselves to caring for the sick and their families. Inspire and give insight to all those who are researching and focused on developing a vaccine. Guide the leaders of our nation to follow your will and to speak with compassion and true truth. Halt the spread of misinformation and act with justice so that your family may know healing. We grieve the millions of jobs lost and wages lost. Those has led many to wonder how they will pay for the basic needs of life. Sustain business owners who suffer from the loss of livelihood in this time. Three in one and one in three, O God, you intimately know the importance of community. Look upon those who are living in isolation now, those who are separated from loved ones, those who are single or those without a support system, those who are poor and already have struggled with health care and social services, those where home is not a safe place. Help us to know that social distancing does not mean social disconnection. Help us to reach out to one another, to be the community that we need, to be the community we seek. O Holy One, we lament the systems of racism that are embedded in our society, so ingrained in our culture that some can't even see it. God, we are a people in need of a miracle, in need of transformation. For years and years of oppression, we grieve. We ask forgiveness and repentance. We ask for guidance to help us be proactive, be part of the solution. Ours is a world riveted by division and injustice. God, you have shown us a different path, though. Lead us on the path of love and understanding. Teach us to cherish the diversity that you have given us as a precious gift. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Bring your wind and give air to all those who cannot breathe. Help us to know that you grieve with us, that you always and forever hold us in your loving embrace. We know that hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. We pray for unity, not violence, creative solutions and not destruction. Give us strength that we may care for all of creation, that we may be honored and preserved and protected. For the gift of your Spirit that lives in our church, we give you thanks. For the gift you give each of us to create your beloved community, your kingdom of God here on earth, we give you thanks. For all that you have given us and will yet to give, we give you thanks. May we always be open to your Spirit, wherever it may lead us. And now we are bold to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now let us join together our hymn of discipleship, the summons.
Let my love be shown. Will you let my name be known?
God give you courage to walk in paths of peace, patience to outlast the troubles of the day, joy that radiates from the inside out, love that erases barriers and heals wounds, kindness that touches hearts, gentleness that cherishes children and enjoys creation. May God go with you to love and serve in God's work. Amen. Now go forth in the peace of Christ, loving God and serving your neighbor in all that you do. Amen.